not him adjusting to you. And you know, so many people leave the church is because they wanted God to adjust to them. They wanted God to be Santa Claus. They came up to God like he's a fast food restaurant and wanted to give him an order. And when they didn't get what they want, when they drove up to the window, God said, it's going to take a little while. Oh, God, ain't nothing to this church thing. I'm leaving. Ain't nothing to this prayer thing. I'm leaving. many Christians have this concept of God. Oh, how can God punish me if he's such a loving God? I ain't never read anywhere where it didn't say there was no judgment comes with love. And all judgment is that there's going to be a decision made. To judge means you make a decision. I judge my situation. This is the decision I made. And what God is going to do at the end of the age, all of us going to have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And Christ is going to say, he's going to look at your body of work from beginning to end, saying, like in football, they evaluate players. Oh, we look at their whole body of work and whether or not they're going to give them a Heisman. But that's what God does till at the end time. He's going to look at your entire body of work. Okay, I see, you grew up, your grandma, mama took you to church, and you was in church, and then you got grown, and you went off on your own, you did the thing, but you came back home, and you was there for a minute, and you fell in love with Slick Willie, and he took you off on the path, but then you came back, okay, and then you kind of strayed away a little bit, after the first baby came, you got a little busy, but you came back. He said, but then you finally hung in there. Amen. I'm just being funny, but that's, he's going to look at our entire body of work. Amen. So, watch this. So, it is then when we can be recognized, if you want to know how God speaks, you first have to know and acknowledge God is always working around you. You have to know that God's going to be the one that's going to initiate. God is inviting you into his presence so that he can reveal himself to you wherever you are, no matter who you are, what your age, gender, ethnic. He speaks to whoever he chooses to speak to. And then he speaks through the Holy Spirit. Okay, let me back up. He speaks by his Holy Spirit through the Bible. So that's why it's important that you be in your word. This is why I take the time to make these copies so you can go study and go through this word. Because I know I speak fast, because I got a little bit of time and I get excited. So I talk a little faster. So you can slow it down and walk through it and say, okay, I see what Pastor was talking about. So you can get that revelation through his word. And then watch this. In circumstances, he speaks in our circumstances, in whether they're positive or they're negative, or they're confusing, or misunderstood. God is still speaking through him. Amen. He speaks through people, and more importantly, he's speaking through his church. This is why I don't understand, and this is just a Johnnyism. I see a lot of people out there that have, they got trouble, they're going through, but they won't come to the house of God. Amen. They won't come. You're talking to your girlfriend about your trouble, but God won't speak, but you won't go to the place to hear him speak. But let Lil Wayne show up. And Lil Wayne showed up and said, yeah, oh God, it'll be a packed service. And he ain't talking about nothing. And you have some Christians, I'm just going to drive by and see what it looked like. And they have to creep up there, go ahead, go ahead. Well, that's it. Okay, so then you understand that God is going to speak to you through these ways. He will use all of them, or he will use one. The question is, do you recognize when God is speaking? I've shared this before. I was leaving one seminary because I was being persecuted, but I caught it because this man had no reason to try to kick me out of school. I didn't have nothing to do with it. And so I was like, after I got over the initial pain, I'm like, dang, I've been here 2 years. I'm about to graduate. I said, I don't know what God is doing in this. The next day I'm on the bus and his brother was talking to me and I knew it was a divine appointment. And I listened, he said, you need to come to the hospital. You know, we got a seminary down there. I said, you know what? He didn't know what I was going through. Then why, that wasn't a coincidence. And so when I went down, got in, I was in the school, so when they come in, I was like, I just came to say goodbye. Thank you so much. They thought I was gonna be like, I'm like, nah, man, God got me covered. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm going to go take my study somewhere only to get there and get treated a whole lot better with a whole lot more respect. Amen. Amen. So you have to be mindful that God is working. And then, watch it. So this is what's going to happen. Step number five. Somebody read number five for me. There's going to be a crisis of belief. Number five, somebody.
God's invitation for you is to work with him. Always leads you to Christ. requires faith and action.
Amen. So there's going to be a crisis where God is going to challenge you to believe him or believe your circumstance. Now, excuse me on that. Because I've been through quite a few. He'll take you to a crisis where what he's doing and he's showing you stuff is going to take you to a crisis. And it's going to be your flesh trying to hold on to something. He said, time to let it go. And he said, are you going to believe me that I am going to push you in the right direction, that I have your best interest at heart? Amen. And then number six, he says, it's an adjustment. Somebody read number six for me. Amen. And that's where most Christians fail. They refuse to make that adjustment. They want God to come to where they are instead of them making an adjustment to him. And what I'm learning, I'm really a science buff, and I don't like blood and all that stuff, that biology stuff, splitting over apple, that kind of, I was like, this is all I need to graduate, thank you. But what I learned just by the study of science, that organisms, in order to survive, they have to improvise, they have to adapt to their environment, their ecology, and then they move forward and live. If they do not adjust to the environment, they die. And in your spiritual life, that's why we have a lot of spiritually dead Christians, because they refuse to make the adjustment. In other words, you came into the house of God. You came out, you was touched. And you said, I'm going to join the church of God. But you joined the church on Sunday, and on Monday, you was at happy hour. On Thursday, you was going out with your friends. On Friday, you was going out. And you went out Saturday and stumbled up in the church late on Sunday. See, you failed to make the adjustment, and then you wonder why there's no power in your life. I'm trying to tell you the truth. And then number seven, it says, obey and experience. Somebody read number seven for me.
You come to know God by experience as you obey him, and he accomplishes his work through you.
Amen. I heard Mr. Broom say, he said, marriage is hard. It is hard. But it's God's work, though. Because God ordained it. So, no, you can't do it without God. You can't do it. I'm your pastor. I know I can do it without God. Because you got two individuals who got their own individual will, and it's a continuous process of meshing these two wills together, trying to get on one, and it's hard. And unless you learn, I'm like, catch yourself, Danny. My wife will say something like, what is she doing? I'm like, oh no, I'm not going to go down that road. Okay, honey, whatever. Yes, ma'am. Okay, whatever. It's not that important. You know, maybe I'm just misunderstood. And that's what the Holy Spirit said, keep your mouth shut, you know. And then, you know, she do the same thing. She know, when you sometimes, you know, she's like, okay, I just learned, like, that ain't about how I want to go. So I'm just letting go. Amen. And so, like I said, babe, you know, when it comes to Q, when I'm doing the father and son thing, I don't need you to join in on me that time. When you want to do mama thing, do mama thing, but let me, you know, because you're messing up my, because you're going down somewhere, I want to try to go there. You know? But that takes time. That's what makes you not able just to tolerate, but to appreciate your spouse and her differences, or his differences. That's the work of God. Amen. So you're constantly going to be making adjustments your whole married life. Your whole. But watch this. Where are you going with this, pastor? But you are also married to Christ. So you're going to be constantly making adjustments. Whether you're single, widow, or married, we're constantly going to be making adjustments to Christ. Amen. Now, if you make notes on number seven, I want you to write the word faith there. Because he's talking about faith in point six, right? Point five, he talked about faith there, all right? Crisis requires faith in action. Then when you come to six, seven, when you talk about faith, there's three levels to faith. Level one is belief, okay? This is the theological definition for faith, belief. You have to believe God. Therefore, if God said it, you believe it, it's going to come to pass. But you can't stop there. Why? Because even the demons believe, according to James. I'm going to show y'all the text. Just in case y'all don't believe me, what I'm telling you, go to James. I believe it's chapter 2. I'm going to show y'all. Because I don't know about if it blew my mind. I'm like, what the? When I saw that, I'm like, demon vision? What do you see? Okay, let me see. Give it. Two and 19. All right, somebody read that for me, so you can see it for yourself. James 2:19.
You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder.
Amen. Even the demons believe and tremble, so you can't just stop and believe it, because the demons, that's why it was so funny. It's just funny when you read the gospel, how the demons recognized that Jesus was Jesus, and even the religious folk didn't recognize he was the Son of God. Amen. They, oh God, Jesus came and said, Lord, Son of God, Son of David, what are you going to do with us? Why are you here? Yeah. And he's like, speak why before you tell them who I am. Let them figure it out for themselves. Amen. But you know what I'm saying? So the next level of faith then is trust. You have to believe God, but then you gotta trust that God is gonna bring into pass whatever God promised. And like I really believe in the healing ministry. I've seen God heal people. I've studied God's word on healing, and I know what I said, because I've seen it for myself. I've seen it. This is not somebody that could be a religious. I'm not here just telling you something. I read the book. I've seen God. I've walked in. Y'all, I went to pray for like three different people, and I was this was when I was first in ministry. I was on fire for God. I was just, and I was like, I'm just going. I'm on knees praying over hot. I prayed for Jehovah Witness. He said, don't lay hands on these Jehovah Witness. I said, well, you know what? I'm going to kneel right down and just anoint all four bedposts. And I kneeled down, boom! Gave it to God, went to the next floor, prayed for a little girl who couldn't move her arm. Next day I heard her arm was moving, just laid hands on her, did what the scripture said, prayed for somebody else. And I was like, did y'all tell Brother Freeman? Uncle such and such got up. That was a Jehovah Witness. He hadn't got up all week, so I'm telling you what I know. Amen. But see, you have to trust that it's God that's going to do it. Amen. See, trust. The obedience is number three. That's what he's talking about. See, you have to believe God. You have to trust God. Then you have to obey God. The obedience is what unlocks the blessing to overshadow you. Matter of fact, in Deuteronomy 28, which is where he gives it, he said the blessing will overtake you. Basically, it will tackle you down when you obey God. When you diligently hearken unto the voice of God, it will just boom, hit you. Anybody have that experience? I'll share this with you. I'll share it because I like to be real. Like, you know, we get a bonus twice a year. I get a Christmas bonus and an end of the year bonus in February. So all of us.